What's up, everybody? I'm your host, Steve.
And I'm your co-host, Jeff Tindar.
Well, we got a fun night planned for you guys, so get comfy, get ready, and let's go. Warning! Two students and two adults were harmed in the making of this video. Please play this game at your own discretion. So, for our first segment for tonight, we're going to attempt to take teams and catch 20 M&Ms in our mouth. Our partners are standing at least 6 feet back because of the quarantine. And so they're standing back, getting ready to throw the M&Ms into our mouths. And so then, the first team that reaches 10 is going to swap positions. So I'm on team with Jen, and Ethan's on team with Caleb. We got cops versus Joneses. And so what we're going to do is when one team reaches 10, that team will switch positions, and then the other person will have to catch 10 more, and the first person to reach 20 M&Ms caught on their team wins. So here we go. I'm going to count us down, and we're going to get ready. One, two, three, go.
Oh, yeah.
This industry ain't nothing but a box, but I ain't gonna climb in it. You put me inside a room full of rappers, come back in 5 minutes. I'm gonna be the only one still alive with a note on my chest saying that I did it. You do it for fame, we're way different. Y'all looking weak, we ain't cooking in the same kitchen. Everybody got a shirt with a stain in it. Some of us will never wear it out though. Let me get it. I guess I don't understand. This wasn't part of my plan. Some of these people are thinking cause they heard the name that they really know who I am. Time for these Hollywood people, I'd rather give time to my fans. You'd rather chill with these women that like you for money, but I'd rather chill with my fam, yeah. I'm out here grinding, I'm out here grinding.
Let's go!
You
failed this. Alright, for our next segment, what we're going to do is, since school is officially out, we just got the word last Friday, we're going to be holding a pop quiz. And so what we're going to do is I'm going to ask these guys 10 random trivia questions. And then, whoever gets the most right is today's winner of our pop quiz. So here we go. Here's our first question. What color are aircraft black boxes? Are they black, orange, yellow, or gray?
Black.
Ethan says black. Caleb?
They're orange.
Caleb is correct.
He said aircraft black boxes.
They are orange.
I know they are orange.
Caleb, 1 point. Question number two.
Do you want to know why?
How long is New Zealand's 90-mile beach? Is it A, 35 miles, B, 55 miles, C, 90 miles, or D, 60 miles?
I got that.
Caleb.
It's 90. Has to be.
Caleb says 90. Has Ethan?
55.
Ethan is correct. 1-1. Question number three. What kind of animal is a prairie dog? Is it a dog, a squirrel, a rodent, or a fox?
It's a rodent.
Caleb, rodent. Ethan?
Prairie dog.
That was not an option. So, Caleb, question number three, correct. It is considered a rodent. 2-1. Question number four. In which month does Russia celebrate the October Revolution? Ethan.
November.
You must be.
October.
October. Caleb.
Right. through the possibilities?
November, October, September, or December.
Do you remember the night of September?
Do you remember?
The correct answer was November. Neither party got it right.
That's actually what I said before. Those
2-1. Question number 5. What type of musical instrument is the English horn? Is it A, a horn, B, a flute, C, a clarinet, or D, an oboe?
An oboe.
Ethan says an oboe. Caleb.
I thought it's an oboe too.
Both correct. It is an oboe. So, the score is 3-2. Question number 6. What kind of animal is the firefly? Is it A, a fly that is on fire, B, a winged beetle, C, a flying locust, or D, a winged mantis?
Ethan. A winged beetle.
A winged beetle. Caleb?
I hear the possibilities again.
A fly that is on fire, a flying locust, a winged beetle, or a winged mantis?
I think it's a winged beetle.
Both correct. Again, it is a winged beetle. The score is 4-3. Caleb is still in the lead. Question number 7. In which country are Panama hats made? Is it Panama, Guatemala, Ecuador, or Mexico?
Guatemala.
Caleb? Guatemala?
Ethan? Ecuador.
Ethan is correct. Ecuador. Score is tied. 4-4. Question number 8. From which country do French fries originate? Is it A, Italy, B, France, C, Ireland, or D, Belgium?
Ireland.
Ireland.
I go with Belgium.
Caleb is correct. Belgium is the answer. Caleb's in the lead, 5-4. Question number 9. What is a camel hairbrush made out of? Is it horse, fox, camel, or squirrel? Ethan.
Camel.
Camel.
Camel. Camel too.
The correct answer is squirrel.
Ah, that was my second guess.
Last question. Right. Ethan is down by 1 point.
Whoa.
With the chance to tie it up. In what year did the War of 1812 begin? Is it 1812, 1810, 1815, or 2012? Ethan.
2012.
The correct answer was 1812. You have it, folks. Caleb is tonight's pop quiz winner.
Still haven't won a challenge.
Hey, ladies. I just wanted to remind you that this is the week that we're doing our Bible study on the book of Ruth. We're on day 4 right now, but it's still not too late to join us. Each day I've been sending out what verses you should read, something that I thought interesting, and also maybe a few questions. And a reminder, if you have been going along with us, I encourage you to like send out a message about what you thought was really cool in what you were reading, or maybe a question you have, to just engage in discussion. Last thing, we're going to be doing a Zoom call. That way we can catch up with each other, talk about the book of Ruth, and just grow deeper in the Lord together through this time. I love you. I'll see you later.
Well, everybody, we hope you've enjoyed our different segments tonight, but we do want to take just a moment to go over a piece of scripture and dissect what that means tonight. And so what we're going to do is, in just a couple minutes, we're going to go through Acts chapter 4, and we're going to cover a section that's in there. So if you got your Bible, you can get ready to open it up to that. But I do want to briefly, just quickly, talk about our soap and what we've been doing over the last couple weeks. And so each week, if you've been following along, we've been going through what we call soap over a different chapter of a book of the Bible every single day. And so we started this roughly over 4 weeks ago, and we started with the book of John. And every single day we've read a chapter, and that covers the S of soap, which is scripture. And then O is observation, so we take note, what does the text actually say? What are you noting about it? What do you see that the text is speaking to you? Then application is A, that covers, what does it actually mean to me today? When I read that piece of scripture, what does that mean for me? And so that is our application. And lastly, there's P for soap, prayer. And so that covers, we're going to pray that piece of scripture over us. So when you take note of what the scripture is saying, what the actual text is saying, then you apply it to yourself, and then you pray God's word over your life, you're going to begin to see your life transformed each and every day. And so our prayer is that you would keep up with that. But we did that all the way through the book of John. 4 weeks ago we started, and we got that done. Now we should be up through Acts chapter 7. If you're keeping up with the soap each day, it's not too late for you to join us. If you haven't yet, starting tomorrow, we'll be on chapter 8. And so we want you to go ahead, hop on there, join us for that, and begin to read through Scripture each and every day, because we want to take this time while we're stuck in quarantine, and maybe we have some more time on our hands. We want to be able to say that we came out of this different, that we began to develop these spiritual habits where we dive into Scripture, we read God's Word, and it begins to transform our lives. And so, tonight we're going to go ahead and get jumping into our chapter. It's Acts chapter 4. But I want to challenge you during this time, even though we're on a video, even though it feels maybe not quite like a normal service, you don't feel like this is our normal Bible study, what I really want to challenge you to do is grab your Bible, grab a journal, take some notes, and get ready, because this is our opportunity right now where we can say, God, I'm going to spend the next 15 to 20 minutes hearing from you, and I want to be encouraged in my faith. And so my challenge is to you is, even during this time where it maybe feels difficult, I want to really challenge you and inspire you to hopefully gain something from this tonight, that you're diving after God's word, you're seeing what God wants to speak to you even during this time. So get ready, we're going to hop in right now into Acts chapter 4. And we're going to actually start in verse 13 tonight, but before we do that, I want to give you just a brief little background of what's going on here in the book of Acts during this time. So the first thing that I want you to see is that in Acts chapter 2, the scriptures say that the Holy Spirit fell on the people in the upper room, that the Holy Spirit came on the people who were praying there, because Jesus had said to wait here, pray, and that the Holy Spirit's going to fall on you. And so what happens is that those people listened to Jesus, they stayed in the upper room, and the Holy Spirit fell on them and baptized them. And so we see here in this scripture that what happens is the Holy Spirit fell on them and it baptized them. And so we're going to talk about that in the weeks to come and what that looks like. But what happens here is that the people listened to Jesus and they felt the Holy Spirit in a new way. And so that they were given a boldness. The scripture says that they received power when they felt the Holy Spirit for the first time. And so we have that same access to the Holy Spirit today. So that's the first thing I want you to note before we hop into tonight's scripture. And then the second thing that you need to know before we read tonight's scripture is that in Acts chapter 3, we actually see that Peter and John, they were on their way to the temple, which they would pray at each and every day, so that it was a daily routine, that they would go down to this specific temple, they would pray. But what happens is there was one day on their way there that they see a paralyzed man sitting there at the gate, and they actually call it called Gate Beautiful. And so when they see this lame man, the scriptures say that the man asked Peter and John for money because he was paralyzed. And so he couldn't work, he couldn't earn his own money. And so what he would do is he would stop the people on their way by and he would ask for money. And it's here that we see Peter and John actually healed this man who had been paralyzed for years. That it says that he had been paralyzed for his entire life. The scholars think that he was at least over 40 years old, and so he had been paralyzed for over 40 years. And so what I want us to see here is that in this scripture, Peter and John have this famous quote where they say, "Silver and gold I do not have, but what I have I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, get up and walk." And the scriptures say that instantly the man stood up, he began to leap, and he was praising God for what had taken place. And so then we see that Peter and John end up, they get into trouble because people began to notice what was happening, that they noticed that this man who had been sitting there for years and years was no longer paralyzed, that this man had been healed. And so people noticed and they saw that Peter and John were the ones who healed him. And so they actually ended up getting brought before the religious leaders in that day and age, and they were arrested, and they were brought before the religious leaders, and they were supposed to explain why they did what they did, and they were to explain and stand before the Jewish leaders, that they had to explain their actions. And so that's where we hop in tonight. And so that's where I want you to pick up in Acts chapter 4, verses 13 through 22. It's a section that's titled, "The Boldness of the Disciples." And it says this, that when they observed the boldness of Peter and John, and they realized that they were uneducated and untrained men, they were amazed and recognized that they had been with Jesus. And since they saw the man who had healed standing with them, they had nothing to say in opposition. After they ordered them to leave the Sanhedrin, they conferred among themselves, saying, "What should we do with these men? for an obvious sign has been done through them, clear to everyone living in Jerusalem, and we cannot deny it. But so that this does not spread any further among the people, let's threaten them against speaking to anyone in this name. Again, so they called for them and ordered them not to speak or to teach at all in the name of Jesus. Peter and John answered them, whether it's right in the sight of God for us to listen to you rather than to God, you decide. For we are unable to stop speaking about what we have seen and heard. After threatening them further, they released them. They found no way to punish them because the people were all giving glory to God over what had been done. For this sign of healing had been performed on a man over 40 years old. And so there's three things that I want you to notice from this passage of scripture tonight. And I believe that this is relevant to what we're facing right here and right now. That we need now more than ever the boldness of the Holy Spirit to come on us and empower us to be better witnesses for Jesus. And so the first thing I want you to take note of, if you're taking notes tonight, is this. That the religious leaders could tell that Peter and John had been with Jesus. The scriptures say that in the very beginning of this passage, that it was obvious that Peter and John had been with Jesus. And so we see this in that the religious leaders, they could tell from their boldness that they were untrained, uneducated, and ordinary men. And so the first thing I want you to notice about this is that that's encouragement to me and to you, hopefully, because that means that there's no requirements in order to have the Holy Spirit empower you, that there's no real trainings that need to take place. You don't need to have an entire book of the Bible memorized. You don't need to have the entire scriptures memorized in order for you to receive the same power and the same boldness that the Holy Spirit gave to Peter and John. And it says that they were untrained, that they didn't have these classical trainings, like they weren't grown up in religion, that they didn't have the classical trainings that maybe other people did. But the Holy Spirit still spoke to these men, and they still used these two men in tonight's scripture. And so that's an encouragement to us that we can be ordinary people, and things can seem normal about our lives, but yet they're not normal, and that the Holy Spirit can empower us in a new way. And so my question for you tonight is, can those around you tell that you've been with Jesus? Because I think that's something that's so pressing in today's society that, man, we hear all the time that Christians fall away from their faith, or you hear about people who claim to be Christians. We can all think of people who say that they're Christians, but maybe they've never been to church, maybe they're not a part of a youth group, and maybe their lives don't look like what a Christian should. And so we can think of these people. And sometimes that can be frustrating. You know, we begin to think that, man, that's just so annoying that person, they say they're a Christian, but they don't know what they're doing on the weekends. They're partying and doing all these things, that their lives don't look like what a Christian should. And that can be annoying. That can be frustrating. But us as Christians, we have to take this as an opportunity to represent God in the best way possible in our lives. And that's the kind of life that gets lived when you've experienced the Holy Spirit changing your heart. And so when you've received that power and that boldness from the Holy Spirit, it gives you a power in a new way of not wanting to live that same old life. And so my question to you tonight is, when people look at your life, and if you were to sit here tonight and look and examine your own life, is it obvious that you've been with Jesus? Because the religious leaders didn't know Peter and John that well. They had just met these men from them teaching the others about who Jesus was in this miracle. So the religious leaders didn't know who Peter and John were, but even to them, it was obvious that they had been with Jesus. And so my challenge to you is simply this. If it's not obvious in your life when you examine it and you say, man, my life is not obvious that I've spent time with Jesus, begin today to start getting closer to Jesus and living your life in a way that's going to be closer to Him. It's going to show in your life to other people. And so my challenge to you is if you do look at your life and it does look like you've spent time with Jesus, continue to press on, continue to live that life, grow deeper in your relationship. But if you haven't, my challenge is that you would represent God in a way that shows boldness and your faith in a new way.
Yeah, so the point too for this scripture is that Peter and John obeyed God instead of people. They were told by the leaders of that time, the religious leaders, to stop teaching about Jesus. But in verse 19, it says that the disciples told them that they were unable to stop speaking about what they had seen and heard Jesus do in their lives and in the lives of those around them. And that is exactly what the Lord wants us to do as well. Like the great things that we've seen the Lord do, we're supposed to share those with people and just share the love that we've received from the Lord. You have to remember that the disciples, they spent 3 years with Jesus during his public ministry. So they saw him do all kinds of miracles. They saw him walk on water, the whole bread, fish thing, multiplying it. They had seen so many things. And now those miracles that they saw Jesus do, since Jesus went away, the Holy Spirit could come here and work in us, right? And so now Peter and John, they were able to do miracles that they'd seen Jesus done. Maybe not the exact same miracles, but miracles very similar to that because they had the power of the Holy Spirit working in them. And something that I read this morning was Galatians 1:10, and it talks about, it's Paul, who you'll find a little bit later in Acts, you'll hear about his story, but he says, am I trying to please God or am I trying to please men? If I was still trying to please men, I would not be a servant of Christ. And so I think that is a question that we have to ask ourselves, like, who am I really trying to please? Even like on our Instagram posts or whatever it is, even when we may be posting scripture or something encouraging, we still have to think, okay, is this something the Lord really wants me to share? Or am I just trying to get more likes or more followers? You know, just you have to examine your heart. And so a question tonight for you is, who are we listening to? Would we have the same boldness and confidence listening to God rather than to people? Would we want and desire God's approval more than the approval of man? And do we truly believe that it's more important for us to listen to God or to listen to people? And sometimes I think that's hard. Sometimes we really are like, oh yeah, everything I do, I want to do it for the Lord and it's great. But then it's easy to maybe get distracted and maybe you get a little recognition from someone somewhere and it feels good and so you just keep wanting it. But remember that like your reward is in heaven rather on earth. Like if you're getting praised here on earth, that's all your reward's gonna be, all the likes, whatever, that's your reward. But if you do things to please the Lord and maybe sometimes they're unseen, like you have a great reward in heaven. So I think that's a good challenge for us to just evaluate in our lives and apply to our lives.
And so our prayer tonight is that you would choose to listen to the voice of God over the voice of man. And that's not to say that you need to go breaking laws, because we are talking about common sense here. And so you have to understand that, you know, especially during these times where during this quarantine, we have rules and regulations that the CDC and the government is placing over us. We're not saying to go and not listen to them. But what we are saying is that you fall under the authority that the people in your life have over you. But the main authority in your life would be the voice of God, that you weigh your choices against Scripture and who they say the life that you should live life looks like. So, our last point for tonight, number three, is this, if you're taking notes. God protected Peter and John because of their obedience. And so we see here in verse 21 that it says that the religious leaders found no way of punishing them. But after they arrested them, they had them, they're standing before the religious leaders, and they found that there was nothing that they had done wrong, and so they had nothing that they could do to punish them with. But I think that we need to understand why, because the disciples were released, and we think, oh, great, good ending to the story, like the disciples did what God wanted, they got released. But we need to understand that it's not this transaction that takes place. Our obedience to God doesn't just mean God then immediately moves, because I don't want us to misunderstand what the scripture shows. But what we do see here tonight is that in this scripture is that when John and Peter, back in chapter 3, when they healed that man, what they did was they lifted him up and they said, go in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, get up and walk. And he did, and he began to run, and he was praising God. The Bible says that he was leaping. And so we see, though, that later on in verse 21, that it says that because the people were all giving glory to God over what had been done. That was the reasoning that the religious leaders felt like they couldn't punish John and Peter, because what had happened was is that people had heard of their healing. They listened to the teaching from the man who was healed and then the teachings of Peter and John. And we see that they were healed and that these people began to listen and worship God. And so if John and Peter wouldn't have listened to the voice of God on their way to prayer, because it's easy for us in our spiritual lives that we almost put on these blinders where we no longer look at the people around us and the hurts that we see. Because John and Peter very easily could have said, you know what, I'm on my way to the temple, and I'm on my way to pray to God. And so what they could have done is they could have ignored that person who was sitting there on the side of the road needing to be healed, needing to be touched by God. And what they did, though, rather than ignoring it and saying, I need to be with God, rather than helping people, is that God's heart is that out of our spiritual lives would produce a practical love for people in our community. And so John and Peter, they represented this in the best way, that what they did was they, on their way to the temple to go pray, they helped this man, they healed this man, and then they continued on their way to go and pray in the temple. And so our challenge is that it wasn't because of Peter and John's obedience, but it was because that many people began to follow God. So we see that God helped them. He protected Peter and John because of their obedience to him. But what we see happen is actually out of their obedience that many people came to know the Lord. And so God protected them from this punishment because of their obedience to him. And so I think we got to ask ourselves tonight is, do our lives live in obedience to God? When we read scriptures like this, when we see that God moves powerfully, he healed a person, he saved Peter and John from having to face this punishment from the religious leaders, I think we need to take a moment and evaluate our spiritual lives and say, God, does my life look like what scriptures does? Does my life live in obedience to you? And if it's not, my challenge to you is simply this, that begin to dive into scripture. Reach out to me and Jen. Let us know how we can be praying for you and helping you during this time, because we want to help grow you guys in your spiritual walks. We want to see you guys develop into your own spiritual maturity. And I believe this, that when we are obedient to God, we're going to see him protect us and take care of us, just like he did to these two in this story. We're going to see God move in new ways in our lives. Our prayer has always been this as a youth group, that our lives, our spiritual lives, aren't just for us, but they're for other people. And so my challenge to you is this, that if your life looks obedient and you're living in obedience to God, what are you doing to help those around you live in that same obedience? Because I believe that when we get our eyes off of our own spiritual selves and when we begin to look for other people who are hurting and need some hope during this time, who need love, that's when we're going to see the kingdom of God advanced. And that's when we're going to see our lives transformed by the gospel. And so Jen's going to pray for us just simply over those three things. The number one, that we see that the religious leaders could tell that Peter and John had been with Jesus. And our question for you tonight is, does your life look like it's been with Jesus? Can people tell when they meet you? The second thing was that Peter and John obeyed God instead of people. So are we living in obedience? Do our lives look like they're following after God? And then lastly, number three, is that God protected Peter and John because of their obedience. So are we living obedient lives that then we see God protect us and take care of us like he did in these scriptures?
All right. Father God, we just thank you so much for this night. We thank you for your word and just that we're able to grow in it deeper. I thank you for technology and just allowing us to be able to hear from the scripture in many different ways and hear from just like your leaders, God. And I just pray that we would continue to grow. Lord God, I just thank you that you just gave us these incredible examples to follow in Peter and John, that they would not just listen to religious leaders. They listened to God above that. And I pray that we would just be so in tune with you that we would know your will and your word, God, and that we would just represent your love. Jesus, I pray that you would help us to not seek the approval of man above yours, God, that we would seek to just obey you, Father, and that we would just lean into you and rest in your peace, in your protection, God, that we would just grow deeper in you, that we would try to spend more time in our relationship with you, God, than we do daily, like on our phones. Father, that we would just realize, I mean, you created the whole world. You sacrificed your son for us, God. You deserve our time. You deserve our love. You deserve our obedience. And yeah, so we just want to give that to you. We give you all the praise and all the glory in your name, God. Amen.
Amen. Well, thank you guys so much for joining us. We're praying for you. Please let us know if there's anything that we can do for you during this time. We love you guys. We'll see you next week.